C major, which is excuse me. This is C major. This is where we are at the moment. This is our home for this explanation of color. Now, there are different notes that make up C major, and I suppose the most obvious notes to mention would be the triad, the notes in the triad. So that's C, E, and G, and that's what they sound. That's what they sound like all together. I'm sure you guys have heard this sound before. It's quite a familiar sound, extremely strong. It's a strong sound. Partly because there's a fifth in it, and voicings with fifths in them are very strong voicings. I'll come back to that later when I talk about voicings in the voicings chapter. But right now, we're not quite there yet. So we're thinking about C. We're thinking about C as a triad. And actually, many people, a good choice of scale for many people when playing in C might be the C pentatonic scale, which is actually C and then the next four notes around the cycle. So it's the first five notes major from C, if you think of the circle as being a major side and a minor side. As I do, you get C, G, D, A, and E, and you get the C pentatonic scale. This is a very C kind of sound, and it's quite unbiased actually in terms of how pulled you are in different directions of feeling very bright or very dark. Certainly in C major. Now, in order to make the C major scale, we balance this pentatonic out by adding one note from the flat side, which is F, and one note from the bright side, which is B. And F wants to drag down to E, and B wants to rise up to C. So pentatonic is a really, when it's enhanced to Ionian, which is the major scale with these two notes, this is a really fantastic like point of balance, because it's being pulled in these different directions and it's still C, and it's great. And so let's take, actually no, before we take anything, let's think about the different scales we can use for C major. There are three modes really in the major scale that we can choose to isolate here. That's the most balanced, Ionian. I may mention different labels in this talk, and actually you shouldn't take them too seriously, because I only really labeled things that were in my mind when I sort of was about 17 or 18 and I went to college for a little while, and people were talking about things that I realized I knew about but I hadn't labeled, things like substitution or extension or, you know, Dorian and things like this. And these are sounds that exist before the labels that we put on them, but we should just see them as the sounds, not the labels. But labels is a useful way of interacting with them. So I dig that as a way of understanding things. Now, so we have Ionian, which is the major scale, and it's the one which is like this. If we think of our bracket on the cycle of fifths as being like this, so it's got three triads in it. This is how we find the mode. C major in the middle, and then we've got G major and F major, and if we join all three of those major triads together, which is and then we get, which is actually C Ionian, all the whole scale in a big cluster. Very cool. And so that's a balanced mode. Now, if we were to go brighter with this, and we think, well, I'm in C major, but I want to really be bright in C major, then what we're going to do is we're going to push this bracket like this. I don't know which direction it is for you, but I'm going brighter, I'm going more perfect. Up the fifth side. So I'm going to incorporate D major as opposed to F major. So I've got C and G and D. This is C Lydian. Some people call this C Lydian. I do sometimes. So it's a lovely sound, very warm. It's a warm sound. It's a reassuring sound. It's a very bright sound, and mainly because of one note. It's one note that's risen, the F, which is risen to. That's the brightening part of this mode, Lydian, and it's cool. And so we have three triads, and actually these three triads are useful to use, because we can, I mean, as I said, triads are so strong that we can actually use these triads in any situation, and they normally sound strong. So I can improvise using just D major, like the brightest possible triad over C Lydian, and be a bright kind of dude, you know, when I'm doing that. It's quite nice. Or I can be C and be very steady, and if we think about the final mode that we can approach with C major in normal terms, this is before we get into other territory. This is called Mixolydian, and it's the one which incorporates the other side. So it's C and F and B flat, which is C and F and B flat. So if I join these together, you get. So we're in C major, and it's feeling very much more kind of, if you compare that, which is Mixolydian, to Lydian, then this is Mixolydian to Very different sounds, but both of them contain C major triads. So both of them are C major, and you can now make an emotional choice as to which one you'd rather portray. Am I feeling like kind of bright? Am I wanting to make an impact? Am I wanting to be shiny, catch the ear's attention? Or am I wanting to mellow things down and look west? Is it? Yeah, kind of west. I mean, west if you want to, but, you know, to bury myself down and hug myself in the plagal side, which is the flatter side. And all of those are still C major. And you may realize that Ionian, which is the least biased one like this, that's the best one to use. Pretty cool. Okay, so, excuse me. We can actually go further in terms of thinking about bright and dark by extending this. Now, many of your jazz textbooks or teachers or people who tell you things about music, they might not have told you about this, which is something I've kind of found that is very exciting, and it's really not too outrageous because it's taking this idea further of the triads that we can use in a scale, and just keep going. So, you know, what we've got with C Lydian, which is C major and G major and D major, so we have three triads which combine to make Lydian, is quite a bright sound, and it's bright because of the F sharp, which is, some people say it's the sharp 11, but many people might just say it's the note that feels bright, or it's that note, yeah. Now, if we take A major and include that within our thing, we can actually move the three even further like this. We don't even need to use C anymore in our C major triad. Then we get to other territory. Which, I mean, I call this super Lydian, but the idea is that it's one triad beyond Lydian. So we have a sharp note at the top, which is not the sharp 11, but it's the sharp 15, which is actually the root, ironically enough. So in C major, this is a C sharp, and it's over C major 7 chord. Bizarre. You might be outraged by this, maybe infuriated, but I don't care. And I'm going to show you how that sounds. So we got C, and we got C, and then C superglottis. Very bright, very extremely bright, because we're continuing the fifth sound past the limit. You know, most people would say that Lydian stops at D major. And I disagree, and I say it can keep going, and you can get to super Lydian, and actually you can get super beyond that, and you can go four more triads beyond. You can include a G sharp, and then a D sharp, and an A sharp, and even an E sharp, which includes every note in the chromatic scale. I call this as an idea, I call it quinta Lydian, because it's quinta means five, and you can have quintal grooves in five divisions as well, if you want to. And it's because it goes five times beyond the five more triads, in addition to the... Anyway, yeah, that's cool. And so actually I call the most extreme one super, ultra, hyper, mega, meta Lydian, which I can't actually explain this the sound of that very easily because my harmonizer doesn't really go that high on this smaller MIDI keyboard. But I'm telling you, it's super bright and you've got to beware. That's kind of crazy. And this is kind of not imaginary. It really exists. And I use it a lot in my vocal arrangements that you may have heard online. If I want to be super bright, you know, or be unexpected or something, it's an amazing colour. The idea, I think, is to fill up your palette with as many colours as you can and to hopefully tie them to feelings you have as opposed to things you understand on the left side of your brain. You should try and understand them on the right side of your brain by sort of feeling them in your body and in your mind and understanding that they come from a place which is expressive. I'm going to keep on talking about that. I think it's kind of important. Taylor Charles Smith has just asked a question, and it's about the scale that you can play, if there is a possible scale to play, the quinta Lydian scale, which just keeps going. And actually, there is. If I start on D, which is D, then I can keep going up. Excuse me. If I can actually sing, it goes... And then you can keep going. My cold doesn't allow me to go any higher than that, really, but... Essentially, you're cadencing to the next degree. You know, I'm going C do do D G do 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 do, and then it sort of just continually gets brighter and brighter, and you go, and then the next one will be like, and it's just so bright, and it's not, that's not C major 7 sharp 9, that's C super ultra hyper Lydian. Anyway, these terms might not mean that much to you, but in truth, you understand that as the idea of a circle, there's brightness and darkness, and you can get this in a key. And I think you should get to know the different notes in the scale. If we take Ionian, for example, actually maybe let's take Lydian, because Lydian we've just been talking about. many apologies for this cough. Now, maybe a note that would be good to start with this is kind of like understanding what a word means in a language in some way, but it's bigger than a language because there's more to say because you're not saying it with as much precision. So there's just way more you can say. And you're speaking in a gestural way as opposed to a literal way, which I do believe is the truth and the universal truth. So C, we're in C, and we've got... this is our root note. This is our home. We've put our anchor down here. This is where our ear is led to. A tonal center has gravity, like things have gravity in the universe, I suppose, in terms of we're in a place and our ear is drawn to the floor in one certain area, which sort of gives us some kind of platform on which to stand and understand things. And that's a pretty cool thing to kind of understand and do. So C is our root. And a nice companion of C is the fifth, which we've just gone one notch around the cycle of fifth. So it's our least offensive note of choice because it's right next to C. And the notes kind of, the further the note is away from each other on the cycle of fifths, the more drastic it's going to sound a lot of the time and the further removed it is from C. So C and G sound like this. Apologies. So we got... so this is C and G, like this. Now, We've ascertained that C and G, we've got like this kind of like a rock star type voicing here. And actually rock stars play this kind of voicing a lot of the time, but it doesn't matter. I mean, that just doesn't matter. So C and G we have so far, and we're going to add the most obvious note to complete the aforementioned triad of our choosing, which is C major. We're going to add E, which is the major third. So that would be C, G, E. Now we've got C major. It feels major. Feels like a major triad. I've actually voiced this chord instead of going C, E, G, over the E of that, which adds more space in the voicing. It's like having a different tone of voice when you're saying a word, it changes its meaning. So I've added some space, and that's what I've wanted, that's what I'm doing. So, now, this is a familiar sound. You can play many pop songs with triads, most pop songs, in fact, and many songs besides. Triads are awesome, and many of you guys, maybe the reason you're here today is to understand how to make these triads more colourful. And I'm here to help. Let's add a note to this triad and make it more colourful and see how it makes us feel. So we're going to add the second, which is D. It's also known as the ninth, but it's more known as the ninth when it's got piles of other notes underneath it, like the major seventh, for example. So I'm going to call it the second because it's more friends with the third than it is friends with like the upper extensions in this context. So C, G, D. That's what an add two chord sounds like or feels like. So it's quite warm. I really enjoy this sound. It's a nice thing to do, and it makes the voicing quite strong because we're actually adding another fifth. We're jumping up a fifth from the fifth. We're going C, G, D. So everything is thumbs up voicing-wise because we are extremely strong. Fifths are the strongest voicing interval choice you could ever dream of. It's kind of because of the harmonic series, but I'm not going to go into that until my advanced harmony class. Anyway, we have four notes in our chord. Now, we can think about notes to add beyond this. And one note that we might choose to put in this is the sixth. This could also be known, a.k.a., as the 13th, but then again, that's when it's at the top of a thirds tower. And people in jazz courses and jazz understanders often like list the mode Lydian or something in thirds. So you might go C G B D F sharp because it's just like a like C major, G major, D major. You can literally pile those three triads that we found earlier on top of each other, and it makes C Lydian. And in that context, we might call the top note, the A, a 13th because it's 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13. In this context, it's merely the fifth, by which I mean the sixth. It's merely the sixth of the chord. And so if we get our chord, which is, and we have the sixth, this is what it feels like. Very, very warm, cuddly kind of voicing. And actually what we've done now is we've completed our pentatonic scale. All notes in the pentatonic scale are present in the chord. And it feels like this. This voicing is from the top, we got G, D, A, E, G, C at the bottom. Pretty cool. And it's very exciting because it's all fourths and fifths. And it's just massive thumbs up to you for playing that or even considering that voicing because it's a great one. It can't be denied. It's just so fantastic. So onwards from there, we can add more notes into this chord to make it even more colourful. And the next one I'd probably add would be the major seventh, which in this case is B, the next note on the cycle of fifths after the pentatonic. So we're kind of getting brighter now, in my opinion. We're sort of lightening. See how it makes you feel. So we got... This is the major seven. Now, we've completed our... This is our G major triad. So we're now two triads strong in this chord, in this voicing. So... Bear in mind, you can voice this in different ways. You know, I can voice this as... Which is a very warm voicing with a fifth at the bottom, C and G at the bottom, which is very exciting. And you could also voice it like, let me see. That's C major. It doesn't have a C at the bottom, but who cares? It has the same feeling as C major, with a different like flavour, different taste. And voicings are important to understand because you can really express different things with the same notes just by rearranging the notes. So if you ever have the tendency when you pick up your instrument, like a guitar or a piano or, you know, French horn or anything like that, any instrument, that is, then you should definitely experiment with voicing your chords in different ways. You know, feel how it feels to put the third at the bottom of the chord or the fifth at the bottom of the chord. That's something Brian Wilson does a lot. Brian Wilson is the Beach Boys songwriter, primary songwriter, and he's a kind of musical crush of mine. I'm a huge Brian Wilson fan. And he might resolve to chord one by sort of going... which is, that was actually A flat major 7 to C, but it was G in the base of C, so it doesn't sort of feel like I've landed home. It felt like I was just sort of passing through home instead of landing there. This is the power of the inversion, it's the power of the bass movement. Bass movement is extremely important. It's kind of equally as important as the top melody movement, and if these two are both strong, then everything works fantastically, as you may discover to your delight, things like that. So, you know, so if I'm playing C and I go, you know, that feels different from, which feels different from, because I'm voicing the chord differently. I'm thinking about what to put in the bass. And you could say that putting C in the bass, especially when it's got a fifth in the voicing, is a very strong, steadfast kind of thing to do. And then when you put the third in the bass, it's a little bit kind of like this, and you don't really wonder, you're sort of thinking about it. And then G is really... you've kind of landed on something strong, which is the fifth, but it's not the root. So you're kind of landing in a place, and it's like you're standing still, but you're not home. But maybe home is like behind you or something. It's like an interesting thing to think about. Definitely think about it emotionally, because then you've got the power to communicate with anybody, not just people who understand music. Now then, we have one note remaining from our brightening C Lydian cluster, which we're building right now, and that note is the sharp 11. Which, if we're talking about Lydian beyond. Not beyond Lydian, so anti-super Lydian, that is normal Lydian. That note is F sharp, and it's the sharp 11, and it feels pretty incredible, and it feels like this. So we got... That's our sharp 11. That's how it feels to sing F sharp when you have a cold. Didn't feel great, I'm going to be honest with you. So we got C... major, and now every time we play C major on when we read it from a chord chart or listen to a song or want to transcribe something someone's doing, we have an understanding of these different notes as saying different things. So the sharp 11 is going to brighten our sound, and if you can understand, that's the sharp 11 of G flat or F sharp, depending on what mood you're in. And the sharp 11 is C, and you know the sharp 11 in A feels like, and the sharp 11 in E flat feels like. It's an interesting game to play, thinking about how extensions feel in different keys and bearing in mind that the brighter you are around, maybe the brighter you're going to feel depending on what key you're in. The whole thing is like a gravity navigational thing, and if you can navigate to do with feeling, then you're winning the game. Now if we think of positions on the cycle of fifths as kind of navigational points, it's like a sort of neighborhood. You know, you've got C as your home, and then you've got F on one side, which is your sort of plagal thing, so that feels like that place. And then G, which is like a sort of G, you know, that feels like G. And then you've got all the different places surrounding you. And if you think about all the triads built on every note of the major scale in C major, then you get C, C major, and you get D minor, E minor, F. I'm sure you guys are familiar with these. So you wouldn't have C major, D major, unless you were in Lydian. And we're not in Lydian, we're in C major right now. So that's going to be a D minor because it's F, you know. So if you just play all of your notes, at once, and then have a look at how they look, and you can see all the triads in there. And it's nice to be visual with your instrument if possible. It's quite a nice way of doing it. So so let's think about C and how it feels to approach C from different places. The most obvious place, many of you classical musicians out there, or jazz musicians probably as well, or maybe anybody, you know, anyone, doesn't matter who you are, you're probably going to be quite well used to the feeling of going, because that's a cadence to C, and we've resolved to C, and maybe you put a seventh in that G, so it would be, and that's the kind of thing that you can do as a harmonist, I guess. That's a 5-1 cadence, the most common cadence in classical music, and in jazz, you might be taught to go 2-5-1, and it's perfully fine. That's D minor, G7C, and so one something I've recently fallen in love with, listened to a lot of James Taylor and Joni Mitchell and people like this who do this a lot, is you don't have to approach a key from the fifth side. You can approach it from the fourth side of the cycle of fifths. This is called a plagal cadence, as you may see when you visit your chart that I linked to a while back. So instead of going, we're actually going to go, and it's like an amen cadence for those of you who have been to church or listen to much gospel music. It's a nice feeling. An even nicer feeling, actually, is if you go even further. So, you know, before we were doing D, G, C, we can actually go B flat, F, C. If I go, if I'm in C, and I can go, and that's a nice thing to do, because it's like really affirming a key you're in. You know, if you plagal cadence, if you perfect cadence it, it's sort of like, we're in this key. And if you plagal cadence it, it's sort of like, we're in this key, and now we're just sort of going to be in this key for a little while like this, and then we're going to return to this key. And it really means that you're kind of putting around you're making it your own territory. So if I modulate from C, say to E flat, for example, if I go, then that's sort of like saying, I'm in E flat, okay, you understand? And then if I'm in C and I go, that's a plagal cadence in E flat. Instead of, it's a really reassuring kind of cadence. And cadences are emotional because they're resolving points, and you want to make sure you resolve in the right kind of way. And I guess my point here is, you know, I can go, that's just plagal cadences into different keys. I'm a huge fan of plagal cadences, and I think that it's a really nice way to resolve without being really obvious about it. It's like more of a subtle gesture. Check it out. E flat or E flat. So if I sort of went like, oh, sorry, that's a nice way of returning to C, as opposed to, which is obviously fine as well. And each thing has its different place. But many, I'm guessing you guys wouldn't have checked out plagal as much as perfect, which is why I'm talking about it, and something I've really checked out recently with regard to sort of nestling down. Let's talk about, so we've talked about cadences. So earlier on, I was talking about how different extensions feel in different keys, and we talked about the sharp 11 in F sharp, or G flat, for example, which is C. Now, the note C obviously belongs in a few different places. It belongs in C major, I can tell you that, which is, you know, it belongs in A minor, and it belongs in F, and D minor 7, and it belongs in B flat major 9, and it belongs in G sus, and E flat sus, and G flat and D flat major 7, and many different places besides, like B chordal voicing. It's just fourth up from B. Pretty cool. And it's really fantastic when we realise that pretty much any melody note works with every bass note, bearing in mind that superlydian is possible, and also every other thing besides. And if you think about a mode, as discussed earlier on, being six, kind of like six, like 6 o'clock on the clock, all those, including all those notes, which is 8 notes, so from C around to F sharp, that's C Lydian. And if you move that sort of line of thought, and all the things on this side are part of the scale, then I can do this, and C is a part of every single one of your scales. It's really exciting to think about this, because, you know, C is suddenly C feels different in different keys. So if I sang a C In C, it feels like the root. If I feel it's singing C in A flat, feels like the third. Or A minor, feels like the minor third. Or F feels like the fifth. Or D feels like the seventh. Or D flat feels like the major seventh. Or B feels like the flat nine or the sharp 15, depending on what mood you're in. And A flat sus feels like the third and all sorts of things like this. Then suddenly, one note, you've got the power of all of harmony underneath it. To do with it what you will. Many of you guys might have guessed that that one of my favorite things to do is to reharmonize melodies, you know, that exists already with very rich harmony, like exciting, colorful harmony. And this is really, this is kind of what I'm trying to say here, is that the reason that it's possible to do that is because I've kind of realized how much there is possible. There's so much, I mean, there's everything is possible. There aren't really any rules harmonically, and I don't really see the need to put boundaries on things or labels if possible, but certainly we can be aware that C can exist at the top of lots of different chords. So if I demonstrate that quickly in G, because it's not as high in my... Actually, forget it, I'll do it in C. So I'm going to rise up chromatically with the bass line every single, in my left hand, every single chord, and it's going to be C on the top, and I'm going to prove that C exists in every single chromatic note, and this is only one kind of chord for each, and there are many, many different kinds of chords for each. So, C major, and then you've got D flat major 7, and which is like B flat over D, so like D minor 7 flat 13, and then we've got A flat sus, or maybe like, which is E altered, and then F major, G flat major 7 sharp 11, G sus, and then we got, is that the best one to do? Yeah, A flat major, Ionian, and then A minor, that was adding the 11th and the 9th, quite warm, and then we got, or B flat major 9 or minor 9, and then we got B, we could do B major 7 sharp 15, which is, or, which is quarter voicing, which is actually the first voicing in my sequence, and don't even worry about a thing. Anyway, you can see here that there's many things you can do with one single note, and it's important to understand how much there really is that you can do with one single note, and there's loads, and there's so much you can do. And the only way to discover these and to build them into your language of speech is to really play around with things, and when you find a sequence of chords that you enjoy, is to play them in all keys, because then you understand how different notes feel in all keys, and also it's just an amazing workout for your technique, your harmonic technique, just to be able to visualize voicings and find them. I feel like I can play, if there's a song in my mind, I can choose to play that song in any key of my choosing, which is something it's a place I've reached by experimenting enough with keys to feel truly at home in them all, and therefore I can make a choice about what I want to play instead of making no choice and being forced to play in the keys in which I feel most comfortable. And keys are very colourful indeed when you get to know them, and it's worth it. It's a good relationship to have. I don't think we're going to break up. I just don't think we are. I think we're pretty close, and everyone has a different relationship. And also, I don't think keys can really cheat on me, because everyone has their own keys. So just don't say that they can, because they can't, and they're mine. Anyway, so that's a little geography of things, you know, things to understand about harmony and ways to look at harmony. One thing I haven't mentioned is, I mean, I touched before a bit on voicings. Now, voicings are strong. Certain voicings are very strong. And so voicings with fifths in are strong, like triads. Voicings with fourths in are strong, like quarter voicings, you know, like... These are all quarter voicings, only made of fourths. And I can do exciting things. Force as well as perfect force, like going and finding sequences like that, which is just descending one part and keeping the other part the same and then joining it, and it's going to be very exciting. So when you think about voicings, it's kind of like thinking about how do I want to say something, you know, or how do I want to say something, or anything you can say. I mean, in English and in many languages, there are different ways of saying things, and in England, the way we express ourselves is through intonation. Like I might emphasize a word with a note that I'm saying, or I might make it louder, and that's what makes the impact. If you're from Africa, then the emphasis on the word is actually to do with, not to do with the dynamic or the note, but since it's in more of a rhythmic grid, it's actually to do with the amount of space you leave before a word. So it might be, and that puts the impact on that word. And that's not African, and I wasn't trying to be African with that, and I think you realize that, so that's fine. And so what you find is that there are different ways of saying things which are the same, you know, with different emphases, and you can change the meaning by emphasizing different parts of the words. In the same way you can change the meaning of a chord by emphasizing a different part of the chord. So I can emphasize a note in a voicing by doubling that note, like the fifth. If possible, I try not to double any notes in voicings because there's just no need, and it kind of takes away the impetus of the note if it's doubled, by which I mean not two people are singing it, which is something slightly different, but it's doubled in a different octave. So, you know, if I go, then I've got C, G, C, so I've got two Zs, and that is, that's fine, it's all right, but I think that if I were to do, if I were to lose the upper C and to, that has maybe more poise, and it's, I've said slightly less with, I've said slightly more with less, I think is what I'm trying to say, and what, I haven't wasted a voice, you know, because if you're using six voices, something I like to do quite often is to use six voices, then it's nice to use them and not necessarily to double them up, unless you really want to be warm. But the best way to double up a voicing is to have, is to double track it, to, so two people sing it, or I sing it twice, if I'm recording. And so I often do that with the bass. A lot of the bass part is double tracked, and I'll pan these, by which I mean I'll put them in my stereo mix further apart, like this. I used to do this a lot. I've sort of changing around a bit now, but it means it will surround you. And I've double tracked that note, which is different from doubling. I've double tracked that note, which gives it a bit more sort of, you know, it embeds it more in the soil of our ears, I suppose. And if I were to double that note up in the voicing, it kind of takes away, it interrupts the harmonic series of the note, and it just sort of like, I'm trying to think of a good analogy for this, but it's kind of just sort of like it's like two people saying the same thing at once. It doesn't increase what you're saying. It just annoys you. It just kind of, it's fine if you want to make, if you want to make a choice, like, you know, that, then it's fine. I'm not, it's up to you. That's fine. But, I really think that if possible with your voicings, you should be, quite economical or economic. I really don't know actually which one that is, with the notes you choose, because they're like currency and you should place them well and you should learn how to use them full capacity. Now, obviously, in a voicing, a lot of the tension and release with voicings, because the whole thing is about tension and release, that's to do with the amount of tension you make. It's like a visual tension. It's like painting a picture. And I don't paint pictures, but I do paint sound pictures very much, like often. And it's like saying, I'm going to have light over here, and then I'm going to have shade over here. I'm going to clench my fist. I'm going to open my fist over here. I'm going to clench it over here. Or I'm going to be loud here and soft here, or high here and low here. Or I'm going to have a lot of stuff going on, like lots of trees, and then over here is just an open plain, or sky, and then, you know, it's nice to have a balance of tension and release in everything you do, really, in your life, but definitely with voicings. And so it's nice to think about voicings visually in terms of light and shade. So, for example, if I did a voicing of let's see if I can change key here. So if I did D major, like this. It's a really sonically wide voicing. So it's pretty cool. We have fifths, many fifths. I mean, lots of fifths there. We have, which is third and major seventh. We have, which is a fifth at the bottom. And then we have, oh no, I wasn't, I already said that one. We have, and actually, like that. So, and we also have, like if you've got tons of fifths and a fourth and everything, it's really, really great. And what I actually did there is I chose to colour the voicing in quite a light way because I included the major seven and the 13, I suppose, because there are lots of notes in that chord, and the sixth, and the second as well. So I've actually included A, B, C, C sharp, D, and E. They're all in the voicing. They're spread out, but I chose to make some tension at the top of the voicing, which is kind of like it kind of makes your heart come up a bit, but it's still a release because you're in back home, if you're in D, that is. So it's sort of like, you know, like this thing. And so this voicing is huge because the left hand is, and I've got, luckily I have big hands, so I can play, which is D, A, and F sharp. Pretty cool. I've just seen a question here on my feed. Don't fifths get muddy at really low registers, though? They certainly do. That's up to you to decide when they get muddy. I think if I just put my harmonizer down an octave, so I go, that's not muddy yet, really. Maybe it doesn't sound muddy where I am. It might on the weird internet feed. That's quite muddy down there. That's D flat. And the fact is that that doesn't make it out of bounds. That just means it needs to be a choice when you use it, you know. And actually, a really quite a nice thing to do sometimes. I mean, if you're very low on the piano, then you can. It's better to do an octave because the number of harmonics you hear in the low notes make those notes extremely rich and more rich than if you have a note which is quite high, where all the harmonics are so high that you just don't even notice them. It's quite nice to think about low notes as being very what like old people, like old beautiful people, because they have a lot to say. And a lot of things they have to say are very quiet, and you have to listen out for them instead of just trying to impose your youth on them. Anyway, so yeah, that's a good question. All intervals have different amounts of tension depending on where they are, and normally the more you can make a lot of tension at the top of the voicing, and it doesn't really get too much in the way. Whereas if I were to go, then that just sounds like a big puddle of mud. But if I went, that sounds quite elegant and nice. But anyway, back to that voicing I was just playing. This is, so my left hand is, and my right hand is, so I have four notes in a row, the top of my voicing, and that was a conscious choice. There's a semitone between the top note of the voicing, which is the melody, and the note just below it, which is the major seventh. And actually, if I'm recording that, I might make the major seventh a little bit quieter, because it's not as important as the melody note. So maybe I'd double track the melody note, make that, pan that in the center, and go, and then the major seventh I'd bring down in dynamic, and it would just be one voice. So you know, you hear the hierarchy of importance of notes, and you can only understand the hierarchy of importance of notes if you understand what notes do and what they want to say. So it's good to check that out, as I was sort of talking about earlier. Now, so that voicing is D major. It's a very sonically open D major. It has tension in it, and it has release in it, because at the bottom you've got the fifth, and you've got the top, you've got the cluster, and you've got triads, you've got A major, you've got D. And so it's really an exciting voicing. And visually it's cool because you can see it's balanced, there's open and there's closed, you know. And then dynamically I probably make those notes different volumes. I'm going to make myself a bit louder by doing that. Okay, cool. And so it's all good. I think it's all good here. We're talking about voicings and how different voicings have different amounts of strength. So I could also play D and make myself quieter again. I could do D like, that's quite a tender voicing. It's actually over A. A is the bass note, so it's Brian Wilson, thank you, sort of thing. And the only note I've actually added there is the ninth, or the second, which is the first note we added when we started colouring in our triad earlier on. It's really nice. And that's fantastic. And it's a really clear voicing, and I haven't said anything that I don't need to say. This all depends on the context, of course. And, you know, so it's great to realise that D is written on the chart, or D is the chord of the song, and all the different ways I can talk about D and express D. I could say D major is, I'm not sure how well that travels over the internet, but, which is, you know, that's like, which is like a C major 7 shape, which is fantastic. And then, you know, then the D at the bottom is still a D major triad. And what we've got here is we've chosen our darkest option in traditional major. And we've decided to make this quite dark. And so you've got D major, and you go, and they kind of fight each other. This is really strong. It's a strong shape, you know, it's C major 7. And it couldn't be stronger, really. And then you go, which is D major, which is obviously strong because it's a nice open triad. And so I guess my point here is that strength is the most important thing with regard to voicings, and also with regard to voice leading. So to quickly talk about voice leading before I go on to rhythm. Voice leading is important because each part that you write needs to kind of have a bit of a melody. Otherwise, it just kind of sucks, completely sucks. Especially if you're the guy who has to sing that alto part, which is sort of jumping around like tritones or, you know, minor ninth intervals, and you get a melody which is sort of like, which is just like not a very strong melody, but a melody like is a very strong melody, and you can understand that, you know, that's fantastic. So I think we all understand when a melody has inbuilt strength. That's like something we're born with, maybe, or something that's built up out of familiarity with things like nursery rhymes. You know, like do 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 do. That's nice, you know. It's a very strong melody, and it has a lot of poise. Has symmetry because it sort of comes up and comes down, and it's based out of natural major voicings, major intervals. Sorry, and that means that it's not too drastic. And actually, a lot of the time in arranging, we should try and make some choices. So if one instead of one one part jumping up a tritone, unless you want it to sound like, you know, that's a choice you can make. But if it jumps up a tritone, maybe another part's just going up a tone, you know, and then. I'm trying to think of a good way to explain this, but basically sometimes you can make a choice that this guy can jump, say, like down a whole octave, and then this guy just needs to move a semitone, and it means that the parts cross over like this, but it doesn't matter because each line has a strength, and when all of your lines have a strength, all of the parts of your groove have a momentum, it's actually the same, then you're winning, and every part of your ear is satisfied by that, which is just great. It's pretty cool. Now, I've just got a question. Should every chord have fifths? And the answer to that is, of course, not. Chords don't have to have anything. It's really up to you what you want to say with them. Fifths are very strong, and so if you're going to use a fifth, especially at the bottom of voicing, like, then it's great to be aware of what that does to the voicing. And a lot of the time it's great because it makes it strong. A lot of my voicings have fifths in them, but that's just so happens that it is. That's not a rule I make. You can have a lot of voicings which are strong without having fifths. Like, for example... Yeah, like this voice doesn't have a fifth in it. I went like... yeah, that sounds kind of bizarre with the internet. Maybe if I went... Yeah. That's a beautiful voicing, which is C, E, G, C, E, F sharp, D sharp. You know, up there. There ain't no fifth in that voicing, but it's a really strong voicing because it just sounds elegant, and I probably wouldn't use that voicing if I was going home, you know? But I'd use that voicing if I was evoking some kind of, like, a tension, and then I was going to bring it down, you know? I might resolve it to... You know, and suddenly we're on a voyage, and it's like I've clenched my fist and I've opened my fist. And incidentally, that was C, but your voicing is D-sharp. D sharp, F sharp, E, and then C into B, which is like a B major add 4, and then the top voice rose a semitone, and the bottom voice dropped a semitone, and the top voice also became divided, so it became a ninth, so it was like, and suddenly we're in B minor 11, which is a very comfortable place to be. Apologies if I'm moving quite fast for y'all. But I think there's a lot to say, and I think that's important to understand that fifths are not essential, but they certainly add strength and vitality to voicings, and they can allow you to get away with a lot of stuff, especially if it's weird. And a lot of the time, if you have weird stuff, then a fifth in the thing will just validate it. It's like sort of the world is giving you a thumbs up because you've done something which is solid. But these are choices you should make, not choices I should make, and this is your learning, not mine. So I'm not in control of you. I'm just sharing what's in my world this evening. Let's talk a bit about groove, because groove is a groove which is really strong and very exciting and probably not that symmetrical, maybe. Or maybe it's symmetrical. But you make tension and you release tension and you create momentum. And you can lead people down certain paths and then defy them, which you can do with harmony. Of course you can, because, you know, one voice can lead a melody and your ear goes there and then you don't go there. Things like that, you know, languages like that. And it's quite nice to defy expectation. I try and enjoy every time that happens. I love it when people do it, and I do it a lot in my general life as well, I suppose. Not through conscious choice, really, but just because my mental aesthetic seems to be drawn to that, sort of being, yeah, taking something out of its natural habitat, and then it somehow sort of fledges and flies. I quite enjoy that as an idea. Cheers. Now, things in the universe, I mean, the universe is one thing, actually. I've just got a question, actually, just before I get started, that I'm going to give you some practical paths for self-study. And, yeah, later on I can give you some cool things to practice, but I feel like hopefully I'm giving you some ideas. These are all ideas that I found not through any resources other than things that I'm listening to. And I've listened to... many albums all the way through. When I was kind of still going to college, right now I'm not really going to college too much, in fact at all. because I'm quite busy right now, but every single day I did an album into college and an album out of college, and in 1 year I amassed to about 500 albums. And that was every single different time period, every single different genre. I did a few different artists in their full discography. So, for example, the whole of the Beatles I did, the whole of Joni Mitchell I did, all of Jimi Hendrix. And it's amazing to get, if you teach your mind to be quite open and you familiarize your mind with different ideas without making them concrete, like it has to be this way, but setting up a framework, you know, of kind of like, this is possible. And I understand these sounds, and even if I don't have to name them immediately when I listen to things, I understand that it's a language that everybody uses, harmony, you know, and groove, as I'm about to talk about. And so it creates, if you actively listen to music in that kind of way and understand how they make tension and how they release tension, and also it's important to listen to music without thinking at all, just to listen to music and get a feeling, because that's kind of what a lot of people in the world get when they listen to music, is just a feeling. So, I really say my most important part of self-learning is realizing that there are no boundaries and that all rules are just penciled. They're not penned. So you can really, if you like something, then you should do it. And I think you should encourage your ear to find things that you aren't familiar with and keep challenging what exists. And also don't be afraid to settle on something and really milk it when you want to understand a concept. And I've spent a lot of hours in that piano. This is my inventing room. So that piano has been my piano for about, 15 years, I suppose. I've sat over there and experimented with harmony so much. I mean, a lot. When I found something I want to achieve and I found a path of learning that I want to try and sort of go for, then I've really sat and done it. And I think that's been driven by things I've heard that I'm trying to recreate. Feelings I want to try and recreate and sounds that I want to try and recreate. I spend a lot of time in this room creating weird sounds with things around me, like slowing them down and speeding them up and scratching things and sort of banging things and finding out different ways to get sounds. And that's one of my favorite things to do. And then you make them into a groove and that kind of thing. So with regard to self-learning, I think you should be fearless with it. And I think that one thing I definitely say is if you have some chord sequences that you've found, maybe through experimenting with what one single note can do to different harmonies and trying one simple melody, maybe like, you know, trying that out in many different harmonic situations, then you should find the ones that you like and find out why you like them, and then put them all through all different keys and work out why they feel that way. And don't be afraid to not like something, and definitely don't judge yourself throughout the entire process of learning. I'd highly recommend... I highly recommend reading a book called The Inner Game of Tennis, which is by Timothy W. Galway. It's really, really good book. I mean, amazing. And it's taught me a lot. I read it a few years ago and I still go back to it. And it teaches you about dividing your ego and your information mind, which wants to label and categorize and gain all the time. And then your I suppose it's kind of like he calls it your self too, which is the other kind of self, which is learns without thinking and learns like a sponge and doesn't apply labels to anything. Learning how to balance these and not let the sort of ego and information bit take over your learning process. It's massive. And it's actually a book about teaching. So I've learned a lot about how to communicate ideas without forcing people to sort of do what I do. I think that's a very important thing to understand. Anyway, onwards to groove. So groove building, it's interesting to understand... You know, I guess as with a key, there are different ways you can make tension and release within a groove, like so. So, yeah, so I was saying before, the universe, it's huge, absolutely huge. And I saw this video on YouTube from, I think, 1970s, and it was, some of you guys may have seen it. It's like a guy, someone's just asked what that book title is. I'm going to write it down. It starts with a... Okay, yeah, that's cool. It's there. It starts with a man. This video starts with a man with his hand like this on a picnic blanket, and it zooms out. There you go. It zooms out from his hand into outer space, and you see the Earth get smaller and smaller, and all the different things around it get bigger and bigger, and then that gets smaller and everything. And you understand the enormity of the universe, and then you go straight back in, and you come back to this man's hand, and it goes inside the hand, and you look at all the different atoms in the hand, and how everything is so unbelievably layered, and you can tune into different layers at different times. This is universally true, I think, having I've tried to sort of find the secrets of this kind of stuff, and I think it's so real. These forces are so real, but you can listen to the melody, or you can listen to the harmony, or you can listen to just the melody and the bass note, or you can listen to lots of different things. And with groove, you can listen to or tune into, be aware of lots of different parts of a groove. So, you know, I think it's important to become accustomed to different rhythmic lengths of things. So we have the length of the whole song, yeah? Then we have the length of maybe a section of the song, like the verse and chorus, you know? Then we have the verse. Then maybe within the verse we have a phrase, and within the phrase we might have different bars, you know? And then within different bars there are different number of beats. Maybe there are four beats in the bar, and then within each of those beats there are a certain number of subdivisions. Maybe there are four subdivisions in a bar, and those subdivisions are going to be placed in different ways, and they don't have to be placed solidly and the same and quantized. Quantizing is quite similar to autotune in that if you play a groove in and then you quantize it, it makes everything absolutely the same size. So it's like the piano did to semitones. I don't know how many of you guys know this, but the piano is actually a scam and it's not in tune. And what's actually in tune is the harmonic series. And so, for example, on the piano, the idea was, this is the church had this idea, and it was in order to not have to pay for pianos that could play in all these different keys, just have one piano that played in all the keys. And I'm lucky that they did that, because jazz harmony is possible, and keys, I mean, lots is possible because of that, and modulation and things like that. But it's nice to think about harmony and to understand where it came from. And harmony didn't actually come from the piano. So, for example, the major third, if I just demonstrate this quickly, on the piano it sounds like this. And in real life, it's quite hard to show this with the internet and just that connection. But the real one's slightly lower than on the piano, the real major third, which is naturally in every single note in the universe. Every note has a natural harmonic series, and the fifth harmonic is the major third, as it should be, and that sounds like this, which is a very unified sound, as opposed to, which is quite spread out and it kind of beats. And a lot of people have got used to this, this idea that the piano is in tune and things like that, but I just don't agree. And I think that, I mean, I try and tune all of my vocal arrangements. When I sing them, I tune them properly, you know, so the third's lower, the minor third is a bit higher, the fifth are a tiny bit wider, the fourth are a tiny bit narrower, and then we have, is that right? Yeah, that's right. And then, you know, it's all this exciting stuff that becomes possible when you actually think about tuning. And that's one of the reasons I'm so opposed to autotune, is because why would you autotune? It seems funny, a funny choice when things are less in tune when you do that, because it's tuned to the piano. In the same way that quantizing grooves is making them fit to a rhythmic grid. You know, so I might have, it's my rhythmic grid, like 1, 2, 3, 4. And if I play a groove in and quantize it, it'll just be like, I don't find that interesting nor moving, actually, in many situations, not all situations, but it's important to understand that these subdivisions within a beat don't have to be set out equally, as is the case with much music. It has to be said, a lot of music. I've just got a quick question here, which is, Jacob, is your harmonizer using your own tuning system? The answer to that is, right now, I'm trying to crack a way to integrate this thing called Hermo tuning, which is like a MIDI way of understanding tuning, where it tunes chords adaptively. Haven't found a way to do it in the software yet. We've sort of built this harmonizer out of software and hardware mixed together. What I tend to do is, if I'm singing the third, then I sing. And so I don't play the third on the harmonizer, because you could hear my voice when I play the harmonizer, in addition to the harmonizer. So, for example, if I go, oh, Danny boy, and I go, oh, that's the piano. But if I go, oh, that's proper tuning. And you probably can't hear the difference from your wherever you are, because it's a bit sticky with connection. But, you know, because I'm singing the third and I'm aware of the note I'm singing because of how it feels, I sync that note a little bit, you know. And if I go, that feels way better to me than, which is on the piano. And I guess I've just tuned my ear to understand the difference in sense, and sense is how many how many subdivisions there are in a semitone. So there are 100 cents in a semitone. And so the major third is about 14 cents lower than it is on the piano. And the minor third is about 16 cents higher. And the fifth is actually only 2 cents larger. And many other things besides. But you should check that out, the harmonic series. And yeah, so my point here is that if you think about groove, there are many different kinds of groove you can make in different situations which are applicable, and sometimes a quantized groove is applicable, but I want to hip you guys to non-quantized grooves because it's pretty cool. So, for example, we have four divisions in a beat, and say we're in 4-4, so we got, this is our beat, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, and the divisions are 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, we're in four divisions. All is good. Now, I think perhaps the most popular music, which is wonky, is something like samba. I put my shaker. No, I can't find it. I have to use my tambourine. So samba music, this is straight, right? But samba music is designed to be kind of wonky. So it has like a lilt to it, you know? Like a sort of it wobbles around a bit. It creates a little tension, baby little tension release within itself. Louder, okay, yeah, a baby little tension release within itself, because it's sort of, instead of going go 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 go, where they're all equal, it sort of goes back, but boom boom, so actually like that 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 are the same. That's the first and the third division, and the second and the fourth, if you visualize it like this, these are 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh no, that's the wrong. Maybe it's the wrong way around for you, but I hope it's not. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then these guys are moving. Oh no. Oh, I can't do it. I'm really sorry. But basically, the second division goes a little bit later, and then the fourth goes a little bit earlier. So instead of it being duck, gut, 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 it's duck, gut, 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 and it swings like hell. It swings a lot more than that could swing, but yeah, you know, I mean, you guys probably know about that more than you know about. No, oh, I can't do it. I'm really sorry. But basically, the second division goes a little bit later, and then the fourth goes a little bit earlier. So instead of it being duck, gut, 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 it's duck, gut, 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 and it swings like hell. It swings a lot more than that could swing, but yeah, you know, I mean, you guys probably know about that more than you know about. It's with three divisions. Actually, just before I do that, I'm going to link you to an amazing video. I actually almost cried when I heard this for the first time because it was so groovy. And it's this guy, this is Moroccan guy who talks about four divisions. He doesn't actually talk about it at all. He just plays it like the masters do. And so it's four divisions. It's really, really, really swinging. And it's this thing. Now, if you slow this down, you can actually think about this in a ratio. And I emphasize how dangerous this is because you can theorize everything and you shouldn't theorize everything. But for those of you out there, and I bet some of you guys like theorizing things because I know I do. It's like an addictive thing. But you can theorize that ratio. As a friend of mine once did, he slowed down samba and he sort of analyzed where things are. And he says it's like 3-2-2-3. So if you slow it right down so that within... that's like there are 10 divisions, 10 baby divisions. It's not really like this. The musicians don't really feel it like this, but you can theorize it like this. And he says it's like having 3 and then 2 and then 2 and then 3. So it would be like 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, don't tend to alter the dynamics of their groove, their momentum part of the groove too much. So this is a great clear example. With three divisions, there's a ratio called, 4-2-3. There's a great example of a ratio in three divisions which grooves like hell. And that's sort of, so that's kind of like, instead of like, it's sort of like, and I'm going to link you to one of those right now. Same dude, Majid Bekkaz, the Moroccan master of this is called like Gnawa music, by the way. Here's another link to this guy Hamid. Amazing. It just feels so good, guys. So good. It's really, it's amazing, and it's It's been so lost in Western music because everybody thinks that the way to make pop music is to make it perfect. So to make it perfectly auto-tuned, which ironically is not in tune, and then perfectly in time by quantizing all the life out of things. And for me, the music that moves me the most is the music where there is just got space to breathe and there are actually human beings playing. And this is just mastery at work. This is incredible. So 4-2-3 and 3-2-2-3, different swing ratios. You can try this out by finding a way of making MIDI information on a computer and then slowing it right down and putting the things in and spinning it back up again to see how it feels. And it's cool. It's a nice way of experimenting with groove and realizing that things don't have to be this idea in hip-hop of lilting the groove. Now, people call this different things. I have seen different terminologies. I mean, one guy I read calls this like slugging, and people call it jilting, and I've always just called it lilting because it feels like a lilt. And the idea now, instead of it being like it's like, and you might have noticed I do this on a song arrangement I did called Close to You, which is on my YouTube channel. And it's an amazing feeling to have a little groove because it's not symmetrical. Now, instead of it being like, it's like, and you might have noticed I do this on a song arrangement I did called Close to You, which is on my YouTube channel. And it's an amazing feeling to have a little groove because it's not symmetrical and it grooves like hell. And a lot of people have pioneered this. D'Angelo is one of those people, and another one is Jay Diller. The band The Roots. I do apologise. I'm just going to check that that's the case before I sort of chastise myself. Yeah, it does work for me. Oh, I'm sorry it doesn't work for you. Gosh. Yeah, if you type in Hamid, if you type in Maymuna, which is Maymuna into YouTube, that's the video. Check it out. That is, by this guy Hamid. Pretty cool. So theorized divisions for slugging, someone's just asked. So there's a way you can ratio this out. Pretty cool. So theorized divisions for slugging, someone's just asked. So there's a way you can ratio this out, which is cool. And for example, if you have a beat in five divisions, which I'm going to talk about in a second. Actually, I'll talk about that now. You know what? Talk about it now. So, okay, so we've talked about three divisions, four divisions. Five divisions was a huge breakthrough for me when I realized beats didn't have to be like, or, but it could be like, and it's great. And it's in five, and you could do stuff like, which is like 3/5. Lots of cool stuff to check out. And I'll talk about that more in my advanced groove class. And so five divisions gives you the ratio 3-2, which is sort of like, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. That's like an ordinary lilt groove ratio. A slightly more exciting one, the more subtle one that I've recently fallen in love with, and I employed during Close to You in the groovy section in the middle with a bit in it, is 4-3. So this is when you get a beat and divide it into seven subdivisions, which is sort of like, and it's just really exciting. And 4-3 is, so it's slightly less steep than, but it's still really cool. And obviously the most obvious lilt ratio is maybe 2-1, but that's actually triplets, so I wouldn't categorize that as a lilt ratio, but certainly a ratio all the same. You should check out different jazz drummers. People like somebody like Tony Williams, who played with Miles Davis, is going to be slightly different from Elvin Jones, is going to be slightly different from, you can check out everyone, Max Roach. They all have different swing ratios to their playing, but definitely listen to them. Don't just try and listen to the swing ratios, listen to them, because they make you feel stuff, and it's pretty amazing. And so lilt grooves, that's an amazing way to think about groove and lack of symmetry. And it's an amazing way to think about groove and lack of symmetry. And it's, yeah, overall, it's a rather exciting predicament to bear in mind that grooves are possible beyond quantization, as harmony is possible beyond autotune. Now then, I'm aware that I don't have too much time and that I have two advanced classes to do after this. So I'm going to skip the thing I was going to talk about next and talk a little bit about groove, but with groove building. So things that are in different places with grooves and how to make grooves swing the hardest. And one of the best ways to do this is actually to bear in mind that a groove is like a conversation. So if I'm speaking to you, I mean, I am speaking to you actually right now, but I can't hear anything you're saying in response, which means I'm here in my room on my own again. I mean, I'm normally in this room on my own a lot of the time. But anyway, if you were here beside me or in front of me or behind me and we're having a conversation, then I might well be speaking with you for a while and then you'd like affirm something I'd say with like a noise like, yeah, or yeah, or something like that. And then you might say something and I'd listen. And it's this interaction, it's this circular interaction of passing energy around a groove, which stimulates the groove. And it makes it exciting to listen to, exciting to be a part of, because you're not in unison. It's like, you're not in unison with another person in the conversation. You're saying different things at different times, but you're joining together with one idea that you're talking about. And this is the same with doubling notes and voicings. You don't need to double a note because it's already there. And you should just trust that it's going to be potent enough and you don't have to shout your point from the top of rooftops of your village or whatever. So I hope that's clear. So with regard to groove making, it's nice to think about different things happening at different times. So instead of building a groove where the groove is like, and the bass line's going like, dum, 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 dum. It's like, that's great, man. But really, it swings a lot harder if the bass line's not doing the exact same thing as the kick drum, because that's in unison. And that's not how, I mean, that could be killing, by the way. That can be really groovy. But if you think about building grooves the way that Africans build grooves, or, groove builders build grooves who don't want to do things in unison all the time, which, you know, and I'm not discrediting that, because it's a fantastic way of building grooves if you want to be unison. But many people don't want to be unison, and in order to create the groove with the most momentum, which flows around the most seamlessly, which I think is the idea of groove, really. The idea of groove is not so much to sort of stop and start. The idea of groove is that something is ongoing and circular enough for you to be aware of how it feels, and it just moves, you know. And I feel that a groove moves more like my hands are moving right now if it's not quantized than if it's like quantized, you know. And these can be tiny, tiny ratios, but I think if you quantize, just press that pressing that quantizing button is like sort of sentencing yourself to death, because it means there's no flexibility for humanity in your groove at all. And actually, you know, if your hi-hat's going like, that's like straight, but the bass line might be going like, and that's like slightly swung, you know. Very exciting, because they're not quite the same, but they groove like hell together, because there's actually a tension in the groove, and that tension keeps you listening and it keeps it exciting. It doesn't mean it gets sterile by things uniting. And I mean, I'm all for things uniting, but just in grooves, it's nice for things to be friends without being the same. It's an interesting idea, but anyway. So it's nice to think about making different things happen in different places. This idea of things being slightly different but the same is actually a great, a friend of mine calls it participatory discrepancy, but I don't listen to him because, you know, that's a theoretical thing to say. Now, you know, this is quite an interesting idea, because the idea is that people are doing slightly different things without being the same in different situations. In different situations of the groove. And one example of this is in samba. Here's my trusty tambourine, and here's a samba groove. My bass line is actually going to not join. This is the case in samba, by the way. This is kind of how samba works, having listened out to like the master samba musicians playing. And the bass operates in a slightly different, he's not thinking about this, but he's in a different grid slightly from the groove, because the groove's going, and often in the samba, the bass goes, you know, great. And if you listen to it, the bass is actually slightly earlier than that fourth division, you know. So you got this, and you got this going, and the bass is almost more playing like a triplet for that first half of the bar, like, and it means that they're not exactly the same. If you quantize things being exactly the same, then You know what I mean? Yeah. So check out other things, you know. Anyway, so weights, yeah, weights is an interesting idea with grooves, because in the same way that conversation, I mean, the same way that Charlie Parker plays the saxophone, he sort of goes like, and little notes jump out at you, and those are the weights, like the most important notes. Same thing in a groove. If everything is the same volume, then, you know, volume is just like, it becomes really sort of, everything's, you can't turn everything up to the full volume, like when you're mixing a song or recording a song, or you can't have everything on full blast, because otherwise it's just too much. And it's nice and groove to think about dynamic with hierarchy, but also to think about this idea that there are some things in the groove which are important, like the weights of the groove. I'm just going to readjust my position. The weights of the groove. So, you know, for example, if there's a groove which is like, I was inventing a groove like, then all the little ghost notes, like, those are like the most groovy parts of the groove, but they're not like, because that's just, you know, that's kind of unsubtle. And so it's nice to be able to create light and shade, as with harmony, as with voicings, in your groove, to bring certain things to the fore. So, that's what, so that's like one voice of your groove, you know? And then like, that's like a different part of your groove. Maybe that's like the sort of, like something in the middle of the frequency, like bat, and then is the bass, and then you've got the something in the upper register, like a hi-hat, or, you know, a rim or something going. And these have different roles, you know? And often they're slightly different lengths. So often you might have the most fundamental thing in the groove. Actually, this really depends on where you are from in the world, but, you know, if I have like, then that's like a whole bar. If this is 2, 3, that's a whole bar length. This is a really interesting idea, and it's cool to bear in mind that this is longer than the momentum part of the groove, which is... That's quite short. And it's exciting to think about this. And maybe the one in the middle is like between those two lengths. And it's, you know, it's cool to think about groove building with lengths of different things, especially when the bass player is maybe playing something harmonically, which goes over a period of time. And so like a form of maybe 8 bars, and then something in the groove is 2 bars long, something is 1 bar long, and maybe this thing at the top is like half a bar long. And that's what makes the groove interesting, because there's all these different areas of light and shade. I need the toilet. I'm going to go to the toilet. I'll be back in 30 seconds. The weights first. So, you know, the weights being the most important parts of the groove, like the main geography of the groove is considered first, and then how to fill the gaps is, that's the joy of it, because, you know, I'm sitting down with my, I mean, often, someone just asked if I washed my hands, and my response was I did actually wash them. So groove making, you know. I had something in my mind, like a groove, the sort of basic framework of a groove, like when it's zoomed out, it's all you can see. But when you zoom in, you see more, like with the universe and the man's hand. And so thinking about that, I recorded vocally, I recorded parts of the groove that I wanted to mark out, you know, and then I sat down and I looked at all the little, the kind of intricacies of the groove. And then they all sort of joined. If they joined together, then that's just like a conversation. So, you know, maybe instead of it being 3 parts of the groove, often when I make grooves, it's kind of like 60 parts, because that's just because I'm like a little bit insane. And also there's kind of too many instruments in this room to not use. So, it's nice to use lots of instruments. And I've got a situation now with my room where I can kind of, if I imagine a sound, then that sound is possible somehow. And even if it means slowing down, like the other day, I'm making an album, by the way, and I'm to get you know, but I don't have a sort of orchestral bass drum kicking around. So what I actually did was there's my double bass is over there, and I set up my microphone in front of the double bass, and then I whacked with this bit of my fist the back of the double bass, and then the string sort of went, you know how bass strings do, and then I slowed that the hell down on Logic, and it sort of became this like kind of sound, which is pretty cool. And then I needed to get like a sort of like sound, and so I thought about it, and I scratched the skin of my djembe, not hard enough to break it, but really hard enough to make a sound like a lion roaring. Oh dear! And I recorded that from the other end of the djembe. I've just had a comment, which is that he heard that groove on SoundCloud, and he may have heard a similar one, but it wasn't that groove. I just wanted to say that. So so the scratching of the djembe, I then filtered that, and it went, you know, like this, and then I needed like a sort of thing. So I found some claves. These are the claves I used, and I did this, which is like, and then I slowed it down. It was like, you know, go. It's amazing. Amazing sound. And so I had my groove, and then I just add little layers, like sort of like and stuff like that, and it just sort of adds colors in the sounds, like coloring in a voicing or something. And so it's a pretty cool thing to imagine sounds in this kind of way, and that's what I've learned how to do with my room. I've sort of got enough things in here now. This is all of the things I've ever done. Yeah, not really that. It's kind of like it's a room full of all the things I've ever collected. I have such a passion for collecting instruments and sounds, and when I go out and about and I'm listening to sounds, I try and pay attention, and I often record different sounds where I am, and then I put them into tracks that I make, you know, and I try and put a little thing into some track or another that's part of where I've been, like that day or that summer or somewhere important, like a friend's house, if like I don't know, something nice. It's like it makes it relevant to you in a sort of nice, jokey kind of way. So it's nice to imagine sound like this. And I think we're on to the part of the talk where it might be nice to talk a little bit about sound for about 10 minutes before we have question time. And that's a weird thing because it's delayed, and sort of, but it worked like 2 days ago when I did it, and I'm going to do it again. But yeah, just to sort of to kind of conclude groove, it's nice to think about the different layers of groove, and that you should start at the bottom and work your way up to the top, which incidentally is how I record my vocal arrangements. I start with the bass and I work my way up, and normally. And to think about different amounts of detail and different things, and to be imaginative with sound is key. Because if you think about your harmonic palette, you know, a palette of your harmonic ideas, this palette is full of harmony, you know, harmony and emotional impacts of harmony. And what a producer's ear does, which I've sort of trained myself to have, and I'd almost say I'm more of a producer than I am like an instrumentalist, because I understand music more than I can play it in terms of my fingers moving, and anything I improve on technically comes from something I want to achieve understandingly. So that's kind of the way around I learn. That's an interesting thing. I think that I've advanced my understanding first, and then my technical things have followed. Followed from that. I'm getting some excited questions talking about my vocal arrangements and how I do them. I can give you like a 2.5 minute blow by blow account of how I make my vocal arrangements if you'd like, but I can't hear your response, so I'm going to do it anyway. So first things first, I choose a song, and it's often a song that has a strong enough melody for me to sort of fuck around with the harmony, and it doesn't bother the melody, because melody is strong, has strong intervals in it, and it's a great melody. It's always a song that I love as well, because songs that I don't love are not worth arranging. And I know some fantastic, I mean, people like Dirty Loops, many of you guys know these people, they arrange kind of like not very good songs, or songs which are of a more pop nature and don't have very much substance, and they make them have substance, which is great. And I love those guys, and they're good friends of mine, and that's a nice thing to do. But for me, it's songs that I love that give me the want to arrange them, as opposed to sort of parody them. Anyway, so it's something nice that I tend to do, is to choose a song. It's a really golden moment where you sort of realize it's the song you're going to do it. It's fantastic. So something like Pure Imagination, which has just been commented, that's a song that I've loved for many years. And a nice thing to do with that is to, I mean, I was actually away from home. I was on holiday with my family in Norfolk, which is sort of the coast of England. It's very marshy and misty there. And I wandered around a little bit, and I let the ideas come into my mind, because I had certain landmarks as if I were making a groove. I had landmark points of what I wanted to achieve with this, and certain events came into my mind, like the bit where it goes like, I can't actually do it really that well. But sort of, it's like a vocal pyramid. And that's pretty, it was pretty cool. I was very excited because I hadn't really done that before, but I knew it was possible because it's possible. And if it's possible, then it's possible, you know. So certain ideas come into your head, and you might have ideas for grooves. So grooves first, and I use my cell phone, my mobile telephone. The voice memo function is one of my greatest assets, my greatest friends. And what I did, there's a video for which I did this that's going to be uploaded quite soon, and I'm not going to tell you what it is because that would, you know, that's against the rules. But it's so exciting, really excited, and there's so much in that arrangement, structurally and instrumentally and everything, that I made this Logic project, which is about this big, like as big as the screen, and I put all my little voice memos in sort of like this, and organized them into sections. And so I figured out, and this is just things straight from my mind, you know, I might hear a song I'm listening to and I might think, damn, I like that groove that it's a weird groove I hadn't heard before. So I record the groove, and then every single thing, the first thing I do is just let my ideas just pour out, you know? So it's just like a massive outpouring of ideas. I don't judge any of the ideas yet. It's just, the idea is to separate the judging of the ideas from the actual executing of the ideas, and choosing which ideas have different things. I actually separate my ideas into kind of like gold, silver, and bronze, especially with a cappella arrangements. So something like the gold ideas are like the most insane ideas that ever you can ever imagine, like something so crazy that it just kind of blows your mind a little bit, you know. It's kind of like, and actually weirdly, I think it's because I always push the walls away from myself all the time harmonically, but when I sit down and have this outpouring, then many of my ideas, most of them end up in the gold. And actually, weirdly, I think it's because I always push the walls away from myself all the time harmonically, but when I sit down and have this outpouring, then many of my ideas, most of them end up in the gold category, because they're all so insane. And therefore, I'm just telling me to stop, and I'm not going to stop. Those ideas are for verse three. You know, verse three is often where the most crazy ideas happen, or verse two, you know, some of them are going to be. But the gold, silver ideas are the ideas which are just fab, you know, but they're not so mind-blowing that they have to be like, and they're just lovely, lovely little gestures, lovely little things. And then bronze ideas are kind of like the momentum parts of the groove. So they keep things moving. They don't draw attention to themselves. They are what they are. So the first verse is a nice way to do this. And so once I've sort of made my ideas in a document, then I can choose which ones I want to do. And I have lots of sort of excitable voice memos of me in under my sort of bed clothes, sort of singing voicings and like beatboxing grooves in a whisper, so as not to wake my family. And because I feel very creative in the nighttime, it's just, you know, it's just me, one of those things. And so I have, you know, I have all these ideas, and then I put them into one place and I have a look at them, and then I can make some decisions about what I want to do. And I try things out. I build grooves that were in my mind that I've heard. I might try and recreate grooves. That's a great way of learning how to build grooves, is to try and recreate grooves that you hear and you love. So I do that. And then harmonically speaking, once I've organized which ideas are going to be the most groundbreaking, you know, like a super Lydian chord or something like that. So groundbreaking. I have to save it till the end of the arrangement, maybe. Like the last chord of... And sing, just sing a melody, and then I might spend a couple of hours just literally painting that melody in every single way that I imagine. So I record a line, and then I don't write anything down, but I record a line, and then I record a sort of bass line for it, and then I fill in the gaps, anything I hear, I record, you know. And it's an amazing way of exploring what you can hear and challenging what you can hear, and you just don't stop until you've run out of things that are possible to hear, and then everything is there, and you can make some decisions about what you want to be there. And every single time I've done this, I've learned more harmony, because your ear knows more than you know, and that's like fundamentally the truth. You should read The Inner Game of Tennis about that. That's a good thing. You always know more than you know, but without knowing it. So this is cool. And once the parts, if you think about ranging from parts, it's just like the old school way of Jacob arranging. Then I sit in this chair and I get this microphone up there and I put it down here and I begin recording, and I record each part in like short phrases so I can get them right, like 4-bar phrases, maybe like 2-bar phrases, maybe an 8-bar phrase. If it's like ooh, and that just takes ages, you know, then whatever. So I record bass first, the whole thing pretty much, or maybe I do section by section, I can't remember. Depends. And often I double track the bass, so I might double track the entire bass part, so I record it, then I sing the whole thing again, get it perfectly in tune with the other one, you know. Once that's done, then I move up to part number 5, part number 4, part number 3, and I go all the way up, and there it is, you know. Then I record the arrangement, and any groove that I've recorded, I might have experimented with the groove that I want to integrate, and then I sort of I integrate grooves that I've made as well as the vocal arrangements. And then once I've got my sort of sections done, I put them all together and I think about how to make bridges. And a lot of time bridges are not planned. So for example, there's a bit in Fast in Rhythm where it sort of goes like, and that just sort of, I thought like, damn, I need something here. Found it. It's like beatboxing. I've never beatboxed on YouTube before, so you know what a thrill that was, and things like that. So that was a nice joining section that appeared. It sort of came into my imagination. And that's one of the benefits of listening to so much music, is that things lodge themselves in your peripheral vision, and they're just there, dude. They really are, and it's important to trust that they're there without trying to look at them. Like, you know, if you look at a star, then it's not as bright as if you look at it in your slight in your peripheral vision. I've definitely noticed that. I don't know if you've noticed that, but it's the same with the ideas. If you try and look at your idea and grab it, then it fades and sometimes disappears. If you allow it to be what it is without trying to grab it or gain anything from it, then it's just there, and often it will feed you, and then it's a lovely relationship with your ideas, because you don't feel like you like own them, and it's a nice place to sort of be, you know, where ideas are around you but without you taking credit for anything, which will just like enhance your ego. And if you don't want to enhance your ego, there's just no point. Okay. So I've recorded my whole track. My whole track is mixed and mastered and recorded, and if you don't want to enhance your ego, there's just no point. Okay. So I've recorded my whole track. My whole track is mixed and mastered and recorded, and then there's a room in my loft, which is up there, 2 floors up. So there's the next floor is everyone's bedroom. This is my family home, by the way. So bedroom floor, and then the top is this amazing like attic room that we sort of had done a few years ago. And there's a row of white cupboards in this room, and it doesn't look like you maybe expect, which is like a sort of lab, like a sort of clinical. It's not like that. I mean, it's not like that at all. But the shelves, doors, they have sort of cracks in the doors, and I sit with my head against one of the cracks, so there's a crack here, and so you can't see the crack, you know, that's the joke. And you know, you have this whiteness behind me. So I'll record the a cappella arrangements. I will memorize each part, and it's quite nice to do that. And I have a weird magnetic memory with that, so I sort of tend to remember things if I hear them. So I'll do each part and have to memorize when something goes sort of ba, and when something goes ba and ba, things like that. So the whole thing is quite exciting, that I should stop quite soon. I'm also aware that I planned this little time for some questions. We have an additional 10 minutes of the talk. If you guys want to stick around, then you can ask me some questions. Now is another time to mention very briefly that if you want to have a one-on-one session with me, I would love that. That would be so nice. And if you tip me, then that's a nice way of doing it, and you can sort of battle each other out for that one-on-one session, which is totally free, incidentally, and anything that your heart desires, you can talk to me about, and that could be musical or non-musical, or anything in the world. So I thought I'd bring that up. Anyway, now is the time for questions. You guys can hit me up some questions. I'm just seeing some coming in right now, and I will endeavour to answer as many as possible before my time is up. So how did I feel? I love intervals. This is questioning me. Jacob, how did I feel in college learning concepts that I may or may not have agreed with? It's a fantastic question. I think that education is extremely dangerous, especially for people who don't feel courageous enough to think for themselves. The worst jazz educators are those who feed you ideas without allowing you to question them. And the whole of the educational system is actually awful in many ways, because it allows you not to make, it doesn't allow you to make any mistakes. And if you make a mistake, then you're chastised and punished. Not an ideal way of learning, because with learning, you should be able to enjoy and embrace all of your mistakes and not to make a judgment about allows you not to make it, it doesn't allow you to make any mistakes, and if you make a mistake then you're chastised and punished. Not an ideal way of learning, because with learning you should be able to enjoy and embrace all of your mistakes and not to make a judgment about it, not to sort of say that's a bad mistake and so I'm bad, you know, that's just the worst. And that happens to everybody. It's happened to me in the past, and truly I think it's best if you can enjoy making mistakes, because you can climb up higher faster without, because you're not held back by people's punishments and things like this. But as far as going to college is concerned, I mean, I definitely took education with a pinch of salt, having never really fitted into education in any way. It's secondhand knowledge, and so I treat it like that, and I have my knowledge and I built my own frameworks of understanding, not because I'm like a superhero, just because I've always believed in my own ideas. So I think things can affect my own ideas, and that's how I should be in control of my own ideas. So that's quite nice, really. And I think it's important to bear in mind that you're your learning. Nobody else is your learning, and you should take what you want to take. And it doesn't matter if you disagree with things, because you are you. More questions. Okay, quick recap of Super Lydian. So we have Lydian. If we think about triads, we have C major. Let me get my harmonizer boosted up again. Ooh, C, G, D, A, A. We can keep on going, climbing up the third scale in major and minor thirds. Keep going. There is no limit. And if you think about how bright the sharp 11 is, which is the third of D major, which is your brightest triad of the three of C major, then that only ever gets brighter the higher up you go. So you can go A major, which is the sharp 15, and the sharp, loads of sharps, sharp 19, sharp 21. Don't call them that. Just listen to them, because that's how they feel. So we think about harmony, which doesn't have any limits, and the cycle of fifths, where you gain brightness and you gain upper extensions the more you go up. This is the idea of super Lydian, and super ultra hyper mega meta Lydian is including enough triads to include every note in the chromatic scale, but because they're high up, they can be justified as extensions because they're very high, and everything. So super Lydian is the idea of the sharp 15 and beyond. I guess that's a quick recap. I hope that made sense. Let me have a look at some more questions. So, okay. What's the software and hardware setup I have for my harmonizer? So, I don't know what you mean, Darcy, whether it's for my harmonizer or how I harmonize in the studio. I'll answer both. My harmonizer is a mixture of software and hardware, and we built it at MIT in Boston, which is pretty cool. And so the setup for that, I'm not going to explain, because it's kind of like, some of it doesn't exist yet, so you guys won't be able to get hold of it, but it's, the idea is that it samples my, whatever note I'm singing, and it transposes them to other places, so I can sing up to 12 notes at once with Jacob's voice, and it's fantastic. My current software and hardware setup for arranging is Logic Pro, and I have a few different microphones. You don't need a lot of microphones to record. I did most of my recording on YouTube with one single SM58, which is over there. And that's, it's important to realize you don't need a lot, you just need your own imagination to be creative. But software and hardware wise, yeah, Logic and microphones. I have two C414s AKG. I have a C12 AKG, which is up there. That SM58 remains, and this microphone is an Audix. I use it for my harmonizer, and so that's that. And so that's kind of my software and hardware setup right now. My video software is Adobe Premiere Pro. The last album I heard, you know, I can't remember because I listened to so many albums, but my most favourite album at the moment is Pet Sounds by the Beach Boys. And it's just sonically amazing, really rich, really layered, really emotional, really honest, very fearless, and just incredible. Just check it out if you haven't checked it out. It's really one of the greatest albums of all times. Now let me remember, let me read some, yeah. I hope the song I'm releasing soon is the Ariana Grande cover I tease. Love the sound of that. Thank you very much, Cookie Divine. So the harmonizer is very flexible and allows me to do things like sidechain compression grooves and, you know, stuff like... you know, things that sound like that. All I can say is I'm making an album, and you should probably buy it if you want to hear that kind of stuff, because everything will be in the album. Okay, so what do I think about transcribing? Someone's just asked. I don't really read music that well. I didn't learn classically, and I learned by ear. And recently, I've joined the dots with I've joined my own understanding with the dots. That is, it's not a strength of mine. I don't think it's essential for understanding music, but it's essential for your own framework of sorts. So when I transcribe things, I haven't transcribed a great deal. I'm not a huge avid transcriber, but I've certainly listened attentively and with understanding to lots of things. And so when I listen to an album, I can genuinely hear what the chords are and how they're voiced and what the tempo is and how it feels and how the groove is made. And I've opened up my awareness of things so that it's kind of like a different kind of transcribing, which is more gestural than precise. But I trust my gestural mind, and you should too, because it's kind of it's your biggest asset is your emotional mind and your gestural mind. So I think understanding how people use harmony. I mean, if I listen to a Take Six recording, I've done much of that in my life. And, you know, it's nice to listen to. If you find it hard to hear harmony just as you listen to it, then try and listen to the bass line, sing along with the bass line, sing along with the melody. Try and just sing any part in the middle and see if you can find one that is beautiful. You normally can. A sort of childhood game of mine was to try and find the seventh part in the Take Six records. It's really fun. And that's always like a really shiny and bizarre note, but it really tests your ear out. So that's more, I do that more than I do transcribing on paper or transcribing learning solos. But I've done a little bit, mostly when I was at college, because I had to. So will my album be entirely homemade? Yes, it really will. It's going to be made in this room. It's already being made in this room. And it's 100% Jacob, so look out for it. I'm not going to tell you anything more about it, but check it out. How do I push through from ideas to a finished product? Do you ever get stuck with a good idea but don't know where to take it? That's a great question, 21 Echoes. And a great solution to that, I think, is to let yourself go with it and don't try and achieve what you're trying to achieve with the idea. Just let the idea be and grow on its own. So record it and then listen to it and grow without really thinking. Just add things to it. And you'll normally find some things that you don't like and some things that you do like. And invest in things that you do like and then think about all the reference points for that thing, like all the different genres that could go with it, all the different harmonies that might fit, different densities, different textures. Definitely, if you can expand your textual understanding of things, then you have a really rich, it'll give you a very rich palette for understanding sound and music and things, and it helps you listen, but it definitely helps you create. So I think if you get stuck with a good idea, don't be afraid to milk it as if it were a cow, and also don't be afraid to leave it on its own for a little while and put it in the vault, because normally I've done this, I've got a folder just right behind you on my desktop, and it has all of my ideas in it, and it's really fantastic to have ideas from my entire life in that folder. And I'll make a groove or an idea, and it will stay in there for a couple of years, and then suddenly I'll think, well, god damn it, there's an idea right here that was at this tempo that works, you know, and then there it is again. So don't be afraid to let your ideas go. Don't cling on to your ideas too hard. So that's I hope that answers your question a little bit. I've got five minutes left max. I'm not telling you anything about my album, so you can't ask me about that. I can't tell you how I'm going to feature on it either. And Colin has asked me to say his name, so, you know, Colin. Yeah. And so, any other questions very quickly before I head out? Let me see. How do I clear my ears after long arranging sessions to allow myself to listen to the song if it was new? It's a really good question, and it's something I struggle with a lot, but something I do is to transpose my songs up a semitone and a half and listen to them there, because when it A's on 440, then you can listen to it with very fresh ears because it's not so well-trodden, the terrain, and maybe speed it up or slow it down as well. So that could be one and the same, to speed it up and get it higher. And man, I mean, that really makes you imagine things differently. And when you listen to music with someone in the room, you hear it through their ears, if you have enough general empathy. And I think most of you do, because I just have a feeling. So that's a great way of doing it, to get someone else in the room. And you don't even have to ask them what they think, you just feel how they think. So that's cool. Let me, other questions. Do I have musical dreams? That's quite a big question. I mean, I have a lot of things that I want to do, and I'm not going to rush any of them, but I've got a lot of ideas, and I hope you guys will check them out. Have I played around with the Seaboard? I have, actually, yeah. I played Corey Henry's Seaboard one time, and it's pretty slidey and amazing, and I might do a bit more of that. Mithran said he'd love to have a massive chat about me, about what I mean by gestural mind, and if that's the case, he should probably be the highest tipper, I'd recommend. And you're very welcome. And how many instruments do I play? And I think the answer to that is... I don't know. I sing first, and then I play piano and bass and drums, and then a variety of instruments that relate to those, like guitar is a bit related to bass because it's like fourths, and then, you know, and then I play a bit of tenor guitar, which is fifth, so then I can play mandolin a bit and banjo a bit. But I definitely think about, about listening to your ideas and then imagining them come to life. That's the best way to approach learning instruments, because then you learn your instruments through what you hear, as opposed to learning them from a book or from a person. And if your mind is open enough, then you can probably play with a lot. I think the idea is that you know more than you think you do, and you should allow your ideas to flow. And you should try out different instruments. I think everybody should try and learn drums and bass and something harmonic, because I think drums and bass gives you an idea of time, which is immensely important. And bass, which is the other side of melody, and then harmony is all the colour. So I'd say do that. Alrighty, I think I'm going to head out, dudes. Thank you so much for coming to your own room. Really, really, really such a treat to speak to you all. Hopefully I'll do this again soon. You're very welcome to attend the advanced classes, which are coming out really soon. Going to go into all this in more depth. I think there's like a couple of tickets left for each of them. So that would be fantastic to see you guys there. Have the best day ever. I don't know what time it is where you are, but right now here it's like 8:19 p.m. So I might have some food before I get the next class. But thank you for sharing the music room with me, and see you all soon. And I'm just going to really quickly put my email in the description in case you want.